Let us discuss reactive power requirements and reactive power compensation for the HVDC system. Due to presence of converters in the HVDC operation, the conduction of current through the walls is always delayed with respect to the commutating voltage. So thyristor cannot be triggered ideally at a firing angle of alpha equal to 0 degrees, because at that time the voltage crossing zero reference and there is no forward bias. Consequently, the conduction of valve is always delayed by 2 to 5 degrees, keeping alpha to a minimum level. Still, this being a delayed operation, it causes lagging power factor at the converter, requiring reactive power sources to be connected on the converter bus. If we do not connect the reactive power sources, then the control over the operation will not be effective. The reactive power sources are required both at the rectifier end as well as the inverter end. At both the ends, the reactive power sources will be required. At the rectifier end, the rectifier appears as a load in the system, right? But the inverter can be viewed as a generator consuming reactive power. So this is quite obvious, and depending upon the load conditions on the HVDC system, the firing angle is continuously varying with respect to maintaining power, and consequently, so lagging power factor results in the on AC side of converter. So reactive power compensation techniques are to be studied in this particular discussion. It is realized that the amount of reactive power requirement for converter operation in steady state has been observed to be very, very high, lying in the range of 50 to 70% of active power requirement. And as a consequence, various sources of reactive power compensation have to be put into service in order to be effective and provide good control over the amount of power. Okay. Let us check with the expression for reactive power in terms of DC side parameters. The reactive power requirement of HVDC converters can be derived here by considering three elements of power, that is active power, reactive power and apparent power. Considering the equation, that is a very, very basic equation, that reactive power can be derived from apparent and real power like this, right? Then we have to realize in terms of DC parameters, how can we express apparent apparent power and real power? So the idea is very simple, that during the no load condition, the DC side voltage, right, VDIO, no load DC voltage and corresponding load current, rated value of current, this product VDIO ID, when this much amount of power is being drawn from the converter on the DC side, corresponding power taken on the AC side is considered to be apparent power S, right? Similarly, the real power is the power delivered for a given load condition. So the actual DC voltage multiplied by the DC current, so VDID. For delivering this much amount of power on the DC side of converter, the power drawn from the AC side is represented as P. And if we try to simplify this equation, then we come across this very important relationship, that the reactive power is expressed in terms of DC quantities where VDID is the real power delivered to the flowing through the HVDC line, and then within this particular term square root. So we can see ratio of no load voltage upon full load voltage square minus 1. So we realize that reactive power actually it depends on the ratio right, VDIO by VD. It indicates this particular term here. You can see as the value of actual DC voltage on the line decreases in comparison to the no load voltage, this term, this will turn out to be positive, and consequently the reactive power requirement will increase. And in turn, we have to identify what parameters are responsible for change in the value of actual DC voltage. So DC voltage is governed by the factors cos alpha on the rectifier side and then cos gamma on the inverter side, isn't it? So alpha and gamma, they decide the value of VD, and VD in turn decides the value of the reactive power. Larger the value of VD, closer to VDIO, okay, the smaller will be the reactive power. But generally this VD value is always less as compared to the no load value, considering the variation in the AC side voltage on the rectifier side and so also on the inverter side, the load changes and all those dynamics. So let us take a look at the variation in the reactive power consumption for HVDC converter with variation in firing angle alpha and extinction angle gamma at the inverter end. It is observed that a 10% reduction in the voltage, right, it leads to 15% increase in the current at rated power, and consequently the impact is on the losses. 10% reduction in voltage may lead to approximately 30% increase in the line losses. So this is quite undesirable as far as the power system is concerned. That is why the reactive power sources has to be put into place in order to maintain the voltage profile. The more the voltage remains constant, the lesser will be the increase in the current at rated power, and consequently the losses can be controlled. 30% losses for just for reduction in 10% in the voltage. So that's why we are much concerned about maintaining the voltage level and by providing reactive power sources at the HVDC converter station. Now let us observe the study the effect of delay angle alpha and extinction angle gamma. Okay. For rectifier operation, the power factor angle can be determined as equal to cos phi is equal to 1 by 2 cos alpha plus mu. This is very obvious that power factor depends upon this values. Alpha is the firing delay and mu is the commutation overlap. These equations are very basic for a three-phase converter bridge, okay? And as alpha varies, directly the effect of alpha on the power factor can be evaluated by using this equation. Similarly, at the inverter end, if you observe the equation for power factor on the AC side of inverter is 1 by 2 cos gamma plus cos beta. This is again a very basic equation from the power electronic studies, if you realize. But what we want to take away from this is that with a variation in the extinction angle, depending upon the operating conditions of the HVDC controller, gamma will keep varying, and consequently phi will also vary. So that is what is mentioned over here. And as a result, as is alpha and gamma, there are some finite values always, even in steady state. So that is why the reactive power consumption increases, and it's always required for the stable operation of HVDC converters. Let us check with the characteristics that correlate power factor with respect to variation in alpha and gamma. So kindly focus your attention here. This is the reactive power requirement of HVDC converter represented in per unit basis. Okay, and this is the active power on the x-axis. The active power delivered. It is again per unit basis. We can realize here, let us consider for alpha equal to 15 degrees, right? If the firing angle set for the rectifier end, let us say it is alpha equal to 15 degrees. So assuming we can see here that for full rated DC power to be delivered for alpha equal to 15 degrees, the amount of reactive power consumed is nearly 50 to 60%, isn't it? So this is very obvious. The ratio between active and reactive power, considering the positive slope of this line, we consider at every point of time the active reactive power there in the ratio of 100 is to 60%. Okay, and you can observe that as the firing angle is increased further, right, even for 80% active power delivered, right, nearly 80% reactive power is required. So active and reactive power, they are almost same. So larger the value of alpha, larger is the reactive power requirement. That is what this particular characteristics is representing. Okay, so what can be done in this regard? We have to look for the various reactive power compensation techniques. Okay, so methods of reactive power control. Okay, broadly the methods are classified into two classifications. One is by adjusting the converter control characteristics, controller characteristics, and second is by using the reactive power sources. Okay, so by adjusting the converter controller characteristics, a certain 10% of reactive power compensation can be provided. So this part we are going to consider at a later stage. Let us go into the use of reactive power sources. The adjustment in the converter control characteristics, this also depends upon various other parameters. So there is quite a restriction with this method and its applicability. But the other methods, use of dedicated reactive power sources is what is practiced very commonly. Okay, so we are going to consider the second set of methods first, and then later on we are going to realize how the converter reactive power compensation can be done for using controller characteristics. Okay, kindly focus your attention onto the diagram, right? So there are here you can see this is a HVDC converter is delivering a DC power. Okay, and then there is a converter transformer. Okay, and on the AC side of converter transformer, various agencies that can supply the reactive power has been shown. And this is a AC three phase network. Fine. So focus your attention here that the very first source of reactive power is this. That is the reactive power supplied by the generator itself or the AC network itself. AC network can supply reactive power to a small extent, based on the requirement. Okay, and of course it is for very low load conditions. It cannot supply reactive power for full load condition, because that creates the problem of losses on the AC network. Okay, so only a limited amount of reactive power can be drawn from the AC network, depending upon the norms set up by the power supply utility and so on, right? Then the second most important element that can supply reactive power is visible here, is in the form of AC filters. So we have studied the design of single tune, double tune filters, and high pass filter. Okay, so the filter, it removes the harmonic contents produced due to the converter. Okay, so for harmonics it acts as a filter, but the capacitor in the filter, it supplies reactive power for the fundamental frequency. So it's a dual purpose. As discussed earlier, AC filter, it will remove the current harmonics of higher order, and it will act as a capacitive circuit supplying reactive power for fundamental frequency of 50 Hz. The next element that is visible here that can supply reactive power is a shunt capacitor. So this is quite common. As an electrical engineer, we all know that capacitor banks are installed at the receiving substation, at various industries, load centers, wherever there is a over power factor operation, large number of motors like steel rolling mills and other paper mills, cement industries, wherever there is a poor reactive power, so at that place they have to install reactive power compensating shunt capacitor banks. Okay. The next important element that can supply reactive power is a synchronous motor or synchronous condenser, isn't it? It is basically a synchronous motor operating with a leading power factor and supplying the reactive power to the AC network. Okay, so this is the next element. So first, second, third, fourth, right? All of them, they have their own advantages and limitations, and in terms of, so we are going to study them in detail. At present in the diagram, I'm just showing them at once. Then the next type of element is the FAC devices, that is the static VAR system, that means with the use of solid state devices, that is possible to maintain the power factor. Okay, so static VAR systems. So these are all the, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, these are under the category as listed here, the use of reactive power sources, right? Then the first method is the one which is associated with the converter operation. Here we can make, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then six different agencies are available, options are available that can be used. Either maybe two or three of them, filters are always present, capacitor banks are always present, okay, synchronous condensers are used, FAC devices, depending upon the converter, the amount of power that is being handled by the HVDC substation, few or all of them may be required in order to have an effective control of reactive power, generation of reactive power and stable operation of converters. Okay. So now we are going to move ahead and discuss these various options one by one and consider their relative merits and demerits. So reactive power requirements of converters are met by one or more of these sources: AC system, AC filter, shunt capacitor, synchronous condenser and static VAR systems. Let us consider them one by one. First and foremost is the use of reactive power provided by the AC network itself, right? Some of the strong AC networks, they have a ability to supply the small amount of reactive power required by the HVDC converter or the load, okay, but to a small extent, and that too in case of low load. This is mainly required because if we draw reactive power from the system, then the voltage profile will get adversely affected, and so also it will lead to increasing losses and there will be some stability issues as well, right? So this particular method can provide reactive power, but to a very small extent and is not very commonly practiced. Many power supply utilities do not allow the consumers or the loads agencies to draw reactive power from the system. Power factor has to be maintained a very high standard, 0.98, 0.99 by the at the load end itself. Let us move to the next option, that is the AC filters. AC filters design we have studied in detail, that they provide filtering of AC current harmonics, but they appear or they behave like a capacitor for fundamental frequency. This is very important. And does they provide the reactive power? Okay, dual purpose. They are filtering and so also providing reactive power. So these filters and shunt capacitors, these are actually mechanically switched type, right? is a mechanically switched. That means the capacitors, they may be available in the form of small banks, right? And they are step by step, they are changed. They are not very like smooth variation. They do not provide discrete control, isn't it? But they offer an advantage that capacitors available with the form of filters. Although they are since they are mechanically switched, these devices are lesser expensive as compared to static VAR systems and synchronous condensers, which require specialized controls, electronic circuit, and coordinations. Okay, so these are mechanically switched. Their valves are also used. Okay, so they are less expensive. The advantage of using AC filters. Okay, so AC filters, dual purpose: filtering harmonics, current harmonic, providing reactive power to the fundamental frequency. Fine. These are mechanically switched, and hence they are less expensive compared to the fax devices and the synchronous condenser. Okay. So the limitation of using filters for the purpose of reactive power control is that the filter cannot provide continuous control. Capacitors are available in the form of small banks, and they are switched mechanically. And since they are switched mechanically, there is certain step with which they are switched, isn't it? So this particular step switching of capacitor, it may cause lower order resonance in the network impedance, resulting in the harmonic overvoltages. So filter has this tendency to cause a lower order resonance with the network impedance, resulting in the harmonic overvoltages. Okay, so these are the two limitations apart from the advantage that they are lesser expensive. Now let us focus our interest on the characteristics shown below. The type of reactive power compensation provided by the filter and shunt capacitors. Okay, so please note here we are trying to show that this is characteristics is not only for the filters but also for the shunt capacitors. Shunt capacitors are also basically capacitor banks. They provide reactive power in a stepwise manner. Let us say there may be 10 or 12 capacitors, and according to the load requirements and according to variation in the voltage, the reactive power can be switched only in the steps. Okay, there may be like here you can see step 1, step 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, so there are 8 step control, isn't it? More and more capacitors are added in order to provide the reactive power. As active power requirement increases, the reactive power requirement increases, that we have seen earlier, right? It varies with respect to the firing angle and extinction angle for rectifier and inverter respectively. So as active power increases, the reactive power requirement increases, and consequently the reactive power supplying agency, it must have enough amount of reactive power to compensate for both of these, isn't it? And hence meet the stable operation. Okay, let us check with the shunt capacitor description here. Shunt capacitors, they provide reactive power, but again these are mechanically switched. Okay, and they can provide a discrete type of control. Discrete means in steps. Okay, and as a result, there are two limitations. One is that it results in voltage flicker due to the step change. Okay, if the steps are large, right, and control is suitable only for slow variation. This kind of mechanically switching devices like filters and shunt capacitors, these are for the slow variation in the load. If the variation in the load is very fast or dynamic, then such type of discrete control will provide only voltage flicker and is not found to be suitable. So what are the alternatives in that case? So that we have to look into. So let us consider this. The alternative is in the form of a dynamic type of reactive power generation machine, that is a synchronous condenser. Synchronous condensers can provide continuous control of reactive power. Okay, and since they can provide continuous control, they are also able to follow fast load changes, isn't it? The thing which cannot be achieved using shunt capacitor or filter capacitor can be achieved by using a synchronous condenser. Basically, synchronous condenser is a no-load synchronous motor with leading power factor operation or excitation control. Okay, let us move ahead and check the advantages with respect to the synchronous motor. Basically, it acts as a voltage source, especially for the commutation purpose at the inverter end. Okay, even if the AC system is temporarily interrupted, right, still the synchronous condenser or synchronous motor will be able to act as a voltage source for the purpose of commutation at the inverter. Otherwise, the inverter cannot work stable if it is disconnected from the AC system. So, or maybe with the passive load. The inverter operation is with a beta angle very small value, or right? So, or you may consider firing angle very close to 180 degrees. It is possible only when you have an active load connected at the inverter end. If the load is passive, then you require some support in the form of synchronous motor or some synchronous condenser, which can provide the, for commutation of inverter walls. Next is better voltage regulation during the transients, right? During transients, a better voltage regulation is provided. This is due to the internal damping, counteraction to the armature reaction, isn't it? In the form of amortizer circuits, damper windings are present in the armature of synchronous machines that provides this ability to dynamically adjust whenever there is a sudden change in the voltage. Okay, so it will affect the motor speed, isn't it? Synchronous speed field, it will be affected, and it will induce a counteracting field in the amortizer circuits in order to overcome the armature reaction. Whenever there is a change in voltage, whenever there is a transient, there is an armature reaction, and that is counteracted by the damper windings in the synchronous machines. So that acts as a damping force in order to follow the rapid changes in the voltage with rapid change in the load on HVDC system. While there are so many advantages associated with the synchronous condenser or synchronous motor, there are certain limitations as well. So that is quite obvious, the limitations. You can understand that there is a high cost and maintenance. The synchronous motors are costly as compared to simple capacitor bank, right? Because these are not only motors, there is a controls and a switching circuit, and so requires more space, is more bulky depending upon the power level, isn't it? And since it has slip rings and brushes mechanism in order to adjust the excitation, right, and achieve the leading power factor operation, so maintenance and cost is high, right? And second is the instability due to machine going out of synchronism. There may be a scenario where some transients the damping may not be sufficient by the machine itself, okay, because ultimately the size and rating of this machine cannot match with the bulk power that is being handled by the HVDC system. It is only for the reactive power compensation. In such a case, there may be an instability and the synchronism may be lost. So this is the idea with respect to the synchronous condenser, right? Now let us move to the static VAR systems or the FACT devices. There are two types of FACT devices, mainly fixed capacitor type of thyristor controlled reactor, and next is thyristor switched capacitor with thyristor controlled reactor. Okay, so FCTCR, fixed capacitor, TSC TCR. okay, basically inductor in parallel with capacitor, it balances how much amount of reactive power is to be sent into circuit. So TCR is connected in order to provide the dynamic control over the fixed capacitor reactive power. Okay, these are connected in parallel, and the amount of inductor current is adjusted by appropriate firing of anti-parallel connected valves or thyristors. Let us see the circuit to understand it better. Okay, okay, let's say the same thing, that SVS here can be used for maintaining. Basically, SVS fact devices are used for maintaining the voltage, isn't it? And if you maintain the voltage, naturally larger amount of power can be transferred, and there can be dynamic stability and damping of oscillation. The advantage of SVS. So those are studied facts. They may be realizing it, that SVS is used for basically maintaining voltage support. If voltage is constant, power transfer capability is not affected, then so also if dynamic overvoltages are in control. And lastly, the damping of the oscillations. Right. Let us now move ahead further and check with the circuit diagram for fixed capacitor thyristor controlled reactor. This is an AC line, and you can see that at one point of time there is a potential transformer, and it may, and there is one comparator or controller which compares set voltage with the actual voltage in order to check whether there is a reduction in the AC side voltage. And if there is a reduction, then naturally the reactive power has to be supplied to maintain the voltage. And then this is the circuit which will supply reactive power. It consists of several capacitors or fixed capacitors connected, FC, okay. Several capacitors are there. Two are indicated here for simplicity. And they are connected in parallel with the inductors. But the amount of inductive current is controlled by the anti-parallel connected thyristor, or you may consider this to be a triac, isn't it? So this can, these two anti-parallel thyristor will provide AC current to flow in either cycle. By proper selection of firing angle for these thyristors, we can control how much reactive current can flow through this, and accordingly we can allow more and more capacitive current to be injected. Okay, so this is sum of inductor current and capacitor current. Lesser the inductor current, more will be the capacitor current, and the circuit will appear to be capacitive and supply reactive power. If the voltage profile is good, if voltage tends to rise because of sudden decrease in the load, in that case the capacitive current has to be reduced. So that is taken care by increasing the inductive current, adjusting the firing angle. So this is a simple basic principle. And on the right hand side you can see the VI characteristics here. Okay, for low voltages the reactive power is supplied and the current acts in the current is capacitive. Okay, but for high voltages, that is high voltage on the line, if the load suddenly decreases, the voltage may tend to rise. Okay, so that is taken care by supplying the inductive current. Inductive current means that it will try to maintain the voltage to a reference value. So this is basically VI characteristics, and left hand side is a schematic diagram for FCTCR, fixed capacitor and controlled reactor through thyristor controlled reactor, right? And the idea is that measuring reference voltage and actual voltage. Okay, so the same operation has been explained here in the form of paragraph, that is by controlling the firing angle of back to back thyristors, the operating range lies from alpha equal to 90 when TCR current is maximum, and for alpha equal to 180 degree TCR current is zero. In that case it will act as a capacitor. Okay, and dynamic control action is provided by control signal obtained from the voltage, okay, and reactor current. So voltage and the reactor current is continuously monitored in order to adjust these values. Firing angle of course can be adjusted very easily by some microprocessor based controller, and hence adjust the reactive power injected in the circuit. Next we consider the thyristor switched capacitor and thyristor controlled reactor. See, the difference here is that earlier capacitor was fixed, but now it is also thyristor switched. So thyristor switched capacitor will look like this. So I have not drawn the complete circuit. The reactor branch, okay, in the earlier diagram it was having fixed capacitors connected in parallel. Instead of fixed capacitor, now this will be thyristor switched capacitor. So this provides much better control over the fixed capacitor PCR type of circuit which was discussed just now. Okay, this also reduces the rating of TCR and more provide more dynamic control and lesser losses as compared to FC TCR. This provides lesser amount of losses. Okay, so thyristor switching is faster. That is quite obvious. Is faster than the mechanical switching. Thyristor switching is possible. Okay. And it is possible to have transient free operation by controlling the instead of switching. We can insert the capacitor by using thyristor switch. So please remember, thyristor switching can also be done with the capacitor bank. Okay, but the TCR is added in order to have a dynamic control over the operation. Okay, so we can see down in the TSC provides discrete control over the reactive power. Okay. And this generally the reactor, it is used in order to reduce the rate of inrush current, rate of change of inrush current. So generally whenever we connect the capacitor in the circuit, it tends to draw a large inrush current that has to be controlled with the use of connecting a inductor in series with the capacitor. Okay, let us now move ahead quickly to the advantages, right? Here one of the advantage here is clearly, as I mentioned earlier also, that the rating of TCR is reduced for this circuit, and as rating of TCR is reduced during the inductive operation, what you realize is that there is a reduction in the amount of losses. There is a reduction in the amount of losses. Okay, in this case. Okay. So these two diagrams, left hand side is for FC TCR. Okay, you can pay attention here that y axis is the loss in either case. Dono diagram mein y axis mein loss hai aur x axis mein reactive power supply. This is a reactive power supply. Okay, so generally fixed capacitor TCR, okay, if the operation is capacitive, that is inductor current is less, so the power loss will be lesser, right? But if the voltage profile improves and voltage tends to rise above the rated value due to sudden reduction in the load, in that case the current will become inductive. Okay, the right hand side is an inductive operation. Okay, TCR it is mentioned. So with fixed capacitor and TCR combination, the power loss is generally higher. But with respect to the TSC TCR, this is highlighted here. TSC TCR combination, if the operation is capacitive, right? Now we can see here that for the capacitive operation, there is the loss is relatively more as compared to the first case. But in the inductive case, the loss is lesser. Okay, and of course, for capacitive operation, we don't want the losses to be there. Okay, but this is a relative comparison. One offers more losses for the inductive operation, other offers more losses with the capacitive operation, right? So this is the basic comparison here. Let us now move ahead further and check with the reactive power control via converter action. Okay, kindly focus your attention on the diagram. On the x-axis you have the active power, on the y-axis you have the reactive power, and then there are certain characteristics indicated, right? So first of all, observe here, this is a constant current characteristics. What does constant current characteristics indicate? For constant current, even if the DC power drawn is zero, still full reactive power will be required at this point. As the load increases on the DC circuit, as more and more power is drawn, right, one per unit, so the reactive power requirement will come down, but it will reach at least 60%. So this particular area, very large amount of reactive power will be consumed as load decreases, right? So this is not what we want. Let us now check with the other characteristic, that is constant voltage characteristics, constant VD0 by using constant extinction angle only. okay, constant voltage. If you try to maintain constant voltage, then this red color characteristics indicate that we have seen earlier alpha equal to 15 degrees. This kind of characteristics will result that as the active power delivered to the DC circuit increases, the reactive power also increases, right? But observe the third characteristics here. Observe the third characteristic, that is this part green colored, isn't it? And this is mainly for constant voltage and constant extinction angle combination. It indicates that if you try to maintain constant voltage by keeping extinction angle also constant, then the reactive power requirement can be decreased by some extent. Here you can see one particular point of comparison is shown, that for this particular amount of DC load or DC power, right, with constant voltage, this much amount of reactive power is required, maybe 30%. But for constant VD with extinction angle control, the reactive power requirement is decreased by some percentage. So generally, how much percentage reduction in the reactive power requirement can be achieved by using this controller characteristics or controller action? So it is observed that generally 15 to 20% of reactive power can be supplied by the converter itself for its own operation, just by modifying the control strategy. Just by modifying the control strategy, it is possible to achieve some amount of reduction in the reactive power requirement of the converter by modifying its control characteristics itself. Okay. So this is quite useful, even 10-15% reactive power if we can supply. So this method is other than the first set of five methods, right? This is the first method listed in the topmost classification, supplying reactive power using the controller action. Okay. Then of course this is the description, and it indicates that it is possible to supply reactive power to the extent of 15% by adopting the third type of strategy, that is constant voltage and constant extinction angle control, right? So this is what how we control the reactive power and supply from various sources and achieve stable operation of HVDC converters, right?